After a happy, rather leisurely drive south, I found myself moseying around Puglia for a few weeks, on the hunt for a home. Then the small town of Celia Missapica found me. A stroke of luck led me straight to a small, sunlit house.
Sophia, buongiorno.
With stupidly steep steps, pale ochre and ivory stone walls, I knew I'd found home.
So,
one of the reasons I chose to settle in Celia is that it has no great claims to fame. In short, it's a proper working town inhabited by proper working families. One of the families I became acquainted with quite early on is that of the Macellaio.
Buongiorno. He's my butcher from next door, and he's just nipped in for a quick coffee.
Visiting Franco's shop has taught me so much about how the locals cook meat. And the real stroke of luck, its location.
My butcher's is literally just down the street there. If ever I need a little something special, I can whip out there at about 8:30 in the evening, grab it and come straight back in and put it on the stove.
Look at that.
Buongiorno.
Posso entrare?
Prego, prego.
Grazie.
This is my butcher, this is Franco. His butchery is very, very popular. There's often a queue of people outside. Meat is expensive here. It's something that has to be really proper and it has to be good quality, otherwise people don't really want it. Hey Franco, dimmi, da quanto tempo siete macellaio?
30 anni.
30 anni, mamma mia.
Di generazione di famiglia, papà, nonni, tutti macellai. Mio fratello anche macellaio.
So his brother is also a butcher? Of course he is.
Tu ti scegli il pezzo di carne che vuoi, io te lo faccio arrosto.
Fantastico.
Pronto da mangiare.
That's a lovely rib of beef, very nicely matured. And yes, you can have that roast for you and you can take it home. When there's a festival of any kind, people will be coming and queuing to get rolls from here filled with sausages and bombette, which are those little rolls
bombette,
made there.
New Mariette.
Buongiorno, posso avere un po' di carne di macellaio? Great thing here is that you get your meat freshly ground every time. There's no going and buying some graying package of minced meat, which is always done to order.
Prego.
Grazie,
ci vediamo alla prossima.
Ci vediamo. Ciao, Franco.
Ciao, Sophie. Buona serata. Grazie.
It's obvious that the Pugliese are proud of their traditional way of eating.
Allora, Maria.
I soon realised that humble polpetti, meatballs, are key players in the Puglian kitchen. They feature in a number of dishes, such as Orecchiette al Primitivo, meatballs cooked in a red Primitivo wine typical of the town of Manduria.
Meat in Puglia, it's a big treat. People like to show that they can afford meat. And this actually comes out of the incredible poverty of the area. Meat now represents all that's good in life, I think. Right, so that's my basics in there. Cheese, breadcrumbs, and the minced meat. And I've got this rather magnificant Tropea onion. Tropea's a town sort of on the ankle of Italy. So mostly you would eat these raw. It's a dish of pasta, meatballs, and a sauce made with those gorgeous red onions and lots of red Primitivo wine. The one thing I really miss from living in the UK is being able to pop out for a Thai meal or an Indian meal. Just doesn't happen here. There's the kebaberia. That's about as exotic as it's going to get. You get kebabs.
That's parsley, garlic, a bit of pepper, typical flavours.
Here in Puglia, meat tends to be eaten in big chunks and in large quantities. You get some mixed in with pasta, but not a massive amount. Often it'll be a little bit of sausage or be a little something as a flavouring rather than as a big, big bit of the sauce. This is slightly exceptional because you've got the meatballs in there. What you don't get, that spaghetti with meatballs with the red tomato sauce, which is very American. So how big should I make my balls? Well, it depends really on how you're cooking them and what you like. Because they're going into the frying pan, into my pasta, I don't want them to be too big, I don't want them to be too small. Good, that's all my balls. Rolled and rolled and rolled, and now ready to cook. I better go and wash my hands first. Get the oil good and hot before they go into the pan. It's very tempting, but the worst thing you do is start prodding and moving them around straight away. So you need to wait at least sort of minute and a half. The easy way to tell whether they're ready to turn is to give the pan a little shake. And you see some of them are moving, some of them are not moving. I love going in places like the butcher's because you can get some really good tips for recipes there. And then one time going in, there were three grey-haired ladies in there. I just asked them, what kind of cheese do you put into your meatballs? Oh, golly, golly, golly. Such a big discussion about what should go into the perfect meatball. I'm turning the heat right down because I don't want to burn my onion. So this is another of my granny's pans. This frying pan has been through three generations so far. I think it'll go on for at least another couple. It's good, sturdy stuff. My granny was a good cook. She was a good cook. She was quite unusual because she and my grandfather were vegetarians. And she didn't really start cooking until the war, I guess. So this pan has seen many vegetarian fry-ups come out of it. Now meatballs. Sorry, Granny. One thing I do know about cooking pasta is that you need to salt the water properly. So it's no namby-pamby little pinch of salt. It really should be as salty as the sea. There's always something green and crunchy on the table when you're having your pasta. This is a carosello. My friend Morris is coming around to share the pasta with me. He's lived in Italy for ever and ever, used to have a couple of restaurants in Milan.
Hello.
How are you?
Very well.
Come on in. This pasta is Orecchiette, little ears it means.
I'm feeling very privileged.
God knows why.
Sitting watching someone cooking.
It's got wine in it, so we can't really go wrong, can you?
Primitivo.
So this was a dish that I first tasted in Manduria, hence the Primitivo.
Oh, I see.
I'll just boil the wine down for a minute or so. You don't want to start cooking pasta until you've got your guests here, because otherwise you might overcook it. Hot. Yep, that's done. Okay. Take a little bit of your pasta water and put it on one side before you drain your pasta. Just going to add a little slurp of that pasta water. It is quite surprising just how much of a difference that makes. And what I like is as you do this and as the sauce reduces down that last little bit, the pasta begins to go sort of gentle purple as well. And normally I'd probably put more pasta in. There are enough meatballs for four people, so I hope you are feeling hungry. It's a good smell, isn't it?
Almost come back for seconds.
There's some parmesan if you want it. It's a little bit of carosello. So what do you think?
Excellent. You put good wine in there as well.
Chenier must have changed a lot since you first came here. What was it like when you first came?
Quieter. 20 years? Next time you invite me, we'll have this again. Well, let's make the best chin, of this chin. Wine. Chin, chin.
These days, Chelier has about 20,000 residents. Its tightly packed old streets and its typical ugly modern outskirts mean gardens are a rarity. But still, the agriculturalist soul lives on through the stone and the concrete. Balcony flowers are not enough. Many town families have their own essential piece of countryside nearby. My downstairs neighbour Maria fondly refers to her patch of land as la mia campagna, my countryside.
Oh, bellissimo.
It's a couple of hectares of rich red soil with some 50 to 60 olive trees and a medley of fruit trees. In the centre, a white lamia, a small one-storey building.
There's no running water here, so all the water has to be hauled up. Once or twice I've been here with Maria when she's been watering lots of plants, and I got the job of pulling the water up. It's quite strenuous. Having a little space in the country is really popular. It's a bit like having an allotment, I think. It's the southern Italian equivalent. So buone. These are fantastic. These are white mulberries, and they just come from that tree there.
Maria and Giuseppe, her son, are preparing for Sunday lunch.
Giuseppe!
Setting fires, ready to cook for family and friends.
Bellissimo! This is Dani, who is Maria's daughter-in-law. She's Giuseppe's wife, and she's brought the puddings. There's going to be the pasta, that's very important. There'll be grilled meats cooked on the fire out there, and then afterwards there'll be the crostata, the pudding.